lecture we shall be continuing with our discussion on network security. If you recall, in our earlier lecture we had talked about intranets, extranets and firewalls. Now today in this lecture, first we shall talk about some of the general network security threats that we typically encounter, followed by some discussion on some basic cryptographic techniques. So let us start by some of the basic concepts in network security. We start with the different kind of generic security attacks that we typically encounter in a network or in a computer system. Now, a security attack can be defined rather loosely by any action that compromises the security of information. Now, when we say security of information, we are not specifically telling where the information is located. And also, when we talk about as the security of information, we also do not specify what kind of security. It encompasses the entire range. It can be something related to security or secrecy of information. Security and secrecy are not always the same, okay? So sometime we may want to hide some information, sometime we may want to know who is sending the information, or sometime due to some security attack we may be denied our right to access some information. So all these issues collectively fall under the area of security threats, okay? So talking about attacks, we can classify attacks into four types: interruption, interception, modification and fabrication. Let us try to explain these four kinds of attacks with the help of a basic model where we have a source S and a destination D. S wants to send some information to D. So on this model, let us try to explain these four kinds of attacks. Interruption means somehow the source is not allowed to access or send the information to the destination D. This can be an information, this can be a request for an information also. So we really do not classify, or we really do not distinguish what kind of data is being transmitted. It can be the actual information or request for some information. So interruption means this is some kind of an attack on availability. Some information or resource may be available on D and S wants to access. Due to some intrusion activity, due to some interruption activities, somehow the sender or the source is unable to make that access, to complete that request. Now, this kind of attacks have taken place in networks where a group of hackers, if they coordinate among themselves, they can possibly bombard a particular website with junk packets. So actually what will be happening is that the website, the HTTP server software, will be busy handling these junk packets. Suppose I am a legitimate user, I am trying to send a request for some information. So my request will get queued up at the back of a long queue of junk packets, and effectively I am unable to access the information, okay? So this is the attack on availability. Then we can have interception. Interception means source is sending, but some intruder sitting out here is also reading out the information that is being transmitted. This is attack on confidentiality. This kind of attack is again possible if the intruder gets access to some intermediate network points like a router, say. So all packets has to flow through the router. So if the router is hacked, so all information content of the packets will get disclosed. The third type is modification. This is an attack on integrity. See, here again I am assuming that the intruder has access to some intermediate network node like the router, but here the intruder is doing something more than just passively listening to the packets. The intruder is reading out the packets, making some modifications, then sending it forward to D. Okay? So the contents of a packet is getting modified on its way, right? And the last kind of attack we are calling fabrication. This is attack on authenticity. Here, the intruder was possibly watching the communication S and D were making. After looking at or analyzing a number of such communication, what I can possibly do now is, I can fabricate a new packet and can send it to D in a way D will be made to believe that the packet is actually coming from S. So, this is an authenticity problem. The destination has to somehow verify that actually from whom the packet is coming. If authentication is not good, then the destination may be misguided. Okay? So, these are all the different kinds of attacks. Now, attacks can also be classified as whether they are passive or active. Now, this is a different kind of classification. Say earlier the four types of attacks that we talked about, that is just the four kinds of attacks, but in terms of the way information is modified or accessed, we can classify them as passive or active. Now, passive attacks, as the name implies, they do not make any changes. They passively listen to something, obtain information that is being transmitted. Now, here the intruder is simply looking at the contents of the packets that are flowing from one point to the other. Now, there are two kinds of information the intruder might be able to reveal out of these packets or the contents of these packets. One is, of course, what the body of the packets contain. This is the so-called release of message contents. Second one is also equally important. This is called traffic analysis. Like, an intruder somehow has gained access to my network just by passively looking at the packets flowing. The intruder tries to understand or tries to know that which server in my network is the most frequently used. Now, in this way, the intruder can identify the so-called vulnerable points in my network. If it can identify that these are the three servers or computers which are most widely used, so if somehow I can bring them down, the damage I can make to the network as a whole will be the maximum. So, traffic analysis is also a very valuable, I can say, tool or information to the intruder. And since here no modification is being made anywhere, this kind of attacks are very difficult to detect. Now, in contrast, we can have active attacks where some kind of modification takes place in the data packets. Now, under active attacks, some of this we have already seen, we can classify these attacks into again a number of categories. First one is that authentication attack, masquerade. One entity pretends to be a different entity. So, in this way, the entity makes some modification to the packet or fabricates a packet out of air, so that the destination is made to believe that the packet is actually coming from a legitimate sender, right? Replay attack is also quite dangerous. The intruder can passively capture a set of packets which can constitute a transaction and can subsequently replay them to the server. Now, for example, while I am logging into a server, I am typing in my password or some other authentication information. If some intruder was passively listening to all the packets during this time, then later on, the intruder can also try to gain access to the server by supplying the same packets that I was sending, the login information and the other details. This is the so-called replay attack. Modification is, of course, some changes are made to the packet, and denial of service is also considered to be an active kind of attack because we are logically making some active change in the performance of the network. Some data are being stopped to flow beyond a point or such things. Okay, now looking from the point of view of security service, actually from a user's point of view, what are the different kinds of services I require? So here we can talk of several things. One is confidentiality or privacy. There may be a requirement that whatever I am sending, I do not want an intruder to gain access to that. Second is authentication. The receiver wants to verify that who actually created or has transmitted the data. Third one is integrity. Suppose I am downloading a program code from somewhere. I would like to verify whether or not this is the original version or someone has modified this so as to include a virus program code inside it. Okay? This is the integrity problem, to verify whether the message has not been altered. Non-repudiation is a service which says, suppose using some security mechanism, I put my signature digitally on some document. Later on, I cannot deny that, well, that is not my signature. So, non-repudiation means the system should be such that once someone signs on a document by digital signature or something equivalent, the system should be so robust and safe that he or she cannot deny it later. Okay? It is not possible for someone else to forge that signature. Of course, access control is one service. I want to prevent misuse of resources. I want to have a tag of who are the users of the system. And of course, availability is a service. One of them I already mentioned, denial of service attack, or virus programs that can delete files, make some folders inaccessible. These are all different kinds of security services that we may want. Now, depending on the kind of application, you may decide that among them, which are the security services that are important to your organization or to individuals who are there on the network, and you can accordingly set and implement the security policies. Okay. Here, we look at a generic network access security model. Now, this model is like this. On this side, we have our internal organizational network. This is the outside world. Here, we have the channel through which the data is flowing. And gateway is like a firewall that is protecting our organizational network. Now, this model shows the different components of the system. Like the access channel is, of course, the medium through which the packets or the information is flowing. Gateway is an entity which is trying to filter the contents as they flow. The internal network may consist of computers, software resources, databases. They may all be guided by some security control mechanisms. And I am assuming that from the outside world, there are opponents who are trying to break into our system or to access our resources in a way which we do not want to. Now, these opponents can be human hackers. They can be automated systems like viruses or worms. Okay? So, we should be careful against all these different kinds of opponents. Like a human hacker can mount actual attacks on our network by trying and transmitting packets. Now, a worm or a virus might get into a system if we download an email attachment which contains some malicious code. So, we should be very careful about what we are downloading and what we are opening on our machines, right? Okay. So, now let us first look at some of the basic cryptography terminologies. Because whatever security service you want to implement, at the bottom level, you have to use or implement or utilize some of the basic cryptographic primitive operations, right? So, you have to have some idea about the cryptographic terminologies. Most important concept. behind any network security mechanism is encryption. Encryption means you are trying to hide some information from the intruder. I am transforming or modifying or encrypting the information in such a way that it cannot be read in a meaningful way by the intruder. Okay? So, there are a number of ways for doing this. Broadly speaking, the methods can be classified as either private or public key. They are also called symmetric or asymmetric. In the private or symmetric key encryption methods, there is a single secret key shared by the sender and receiver. The concept of a key will be explaining. Key is something like the key to a lock. I am encrypting a message using a key. So, unless I have the key for decryption, I will not be able to decrypt. Okay? Now, in case of symmetric or private key system, there is the same key available to both the senders and the receivers. Same key is used for encryption, the same key is used for decryption. But for public key or asymmetric systems, there are two separate keys lying with the sender and receiver, one for encryption, other for decryption. Now, this is a diagram that shows a typical information flow in a system that utilizes encryption and decryption techniques. This diagram again shows the different important entities in this whole system. First is the channel through which the data flows. We have the sender who is sending something, receiver who wants to receive. Now, sender wants to send some message. Okay? Here we have an encryption algorithm EA. Sender encrypts the message with the help of some key, let us call it key 1. And whatever is actually transmitted over the channel is the encrypted version of the message. So, even if an intruder sitting out here listens to whatever is going on in the channel, not much can be made out of it. Similarly, on the other side, whenever you talk of the receiver, receiver is running some kind of a decryption algorithm, which again will be taking the help of a key, let us call it key 2, to convert this encrypted message into the original message. So, here we get back the original message. Now, in an actual implementation of such a system, we may need a trusted third party, which sometimes we call as a certifying authority, who may be responsible for distributing the keys to be used by the sender and the receiver. Because otherwise, how do the sender and receiver agree upon the key? If I make you a telephone call and listen, anyone can tap the telephone and know what I am telling, what key I am using. So, it should be a very secure way of transmitting and exchanging and managing the keys. Because in the system, the secrecy of keys are the most important and crucial. Let us first talk about symmetric key cryptography. Now, in a symmetric key cryptography, there are a few terminologies which let us introduce first. The message that you want to transmit, the original message, this is called the plain text denoted by P. Here in symmetric key cryptography, there is a single secret key shared by the two parties. Secret key, we denote it by K. Now, after encryption, whatever you get, that we call as the ciphertext C. Encryption is done using the encryption algorithm, which takes as input the original message or plain text and the key. On the other side, you get back the message by using a decryption algorithm, where you use the ciphertext C and the key K again. Now, one thing is important here, the security of this kind of a system is considered to depend on the secrecy of the key. This does not depend on the secrecy of the algorithm. Some people do think that if I keep my algorithm secret, then my system will also be foolproof. It is absolutely wrong. if you keep your algorithm secret, then some possible vulnerabilities in your algorithm will not be disclosed or will not be known fast enough. A cryptographic algorithm is known to be good, is said to be good, if you make the algorithm public, but the key you keep secret. The total strength of your system will depend only on the secrecy of the key and not on the secrecy of the algorithm. Okay. So, just as a corollary to whatever you have said, the assumptions we make is algorithms for encryption or decryption are known to the public. It is only the keys that we have to keep secret. This diagram illustrates the symmetric key encryption scheme. So, we have the plain text. At the sender end, we use the encryption algorithm to convert the plain text into a ciphertext using the shared key K. So, over the transmission channel, the ciphertext C is transmitted. At the receiver end, again we use the decryption algorithm with the same key value K to convert this ciphertext C back to the plain text. So, this is how the system works in general. Let's see now some examples. Before that, let's look at an issue regarding the key distribution. Now, in a symmetric key system, for every pair of parties, we need a secret key. So, if in general there are n number of parties communicating, for security and safety, every pair of parties must have a different key to enable pairwise secure communication. So, we can say that if there are n number of parties, then the number of keys required will be nc2 or n into n minus 1 by 2. For example, in this diagram, if there are 5 parties, the number of keys which are represented by the edges in this graph, there are 10 edges in this graph. So, there will be 10 keys that will be required, right? Okay. Let us now look at some of the classical techniques for symmetric key encryption decryption. Now, the classical techniques broadly fall under two categories. One is called substitution ciphers, other group is called transposition ciphers. Now, substitution ciphers, as the name implies, here some letters or group of letters of the original message, assuming that the original message is a text. So, we are talking about letters and group of letters. So, each such group is replaced by some other letter or group of letter. So, suppose I have A, I replace A by D, I replace X by P or something like that. So, there is some kind of a replacement that we are doing, and that replacement method should be kept secret. And in the transposition cipher, we are not replacing anything, but we are permuting the letters. Like good, G-O-O-D, I can change it to O-G-D-O. I am just permuting the letters in any arbitrary order to get the permuted text. Let's look at some of the ciphers that were initially proposed. These are examples of substitution ciphers. This is perhaps the earliest known cipher. Maybe you have this cipher, possibly you are also familiar with, because we usually play with this cipher when we are kids. Now, the method is very simple. Say here, for the sake of illustration, what we take is that we have a message to encrypt, like say Happy New Year. We replace each letter of this text, each letter with the letter 3 places after that. Like we replace H by I, J, K, 3 letters after H. We replace A by B, C, D, P by Q, R, S. So, all are moving 3 letters ahead. But for Y, we assume that the alphabets are wrapped around circular way. So, after Z comes A. So, if it is Y, next letter is Z, next to Z is A again, next to A is B. So, Y is replaced by B. So, in this way, you can encrypt a message to get the ciphertext and the receiver can carry out the reverse operation. Okay. Now this is a fixed kind of a transmission where you are always replacing the letters by another letter 3 places ahead in the alphabet. Okay. But we can generalize the idea by replacing, instead of 3 we can make it k. Only the sender and receiver knows the value of k. K can be 1, 2, 3, it can be 10, 15, 20, whatever. Each letter is replaced by the kth next letter. This k is considered to be the secret key. K is known to the sender and receiver and to no one else. So it is easy to formulate some expressions which will actually give you that how to make this transformations. So if you assume that each letter in the alphabet corresponds to a number, A is 1, B is 2, up to Z is 26, then this transformation, the encryption algorithm will look like this: P plus K minus 1 modulo 26 plus 1. Similarly, decryption will be C minus K plus 25 modulo 26 plus 1. You can actually verify with some examples that these expressions are correct. Now, the problem with this simple kind of a cipher is that, well, although we are keeping k secret, but there is only 26 possible values of k. So, even by a brute force attack, some intruder can try out all possible combinations and can decode back the result. But this is actually a way of illustrating, okay? The practical ciphers are much more complex and it takes much greater effort to break that. Now, one way you can increase the complexity of Caesar cipher is to allow something called monoalphabetic substitution. Like in Caesar cipher, the displacement is always fixed. A will be replaced by D, B will be replaced by E, C will be replaced by F, and so on. But here we are saying the combination we are making arbitrary. Like, for example, I can say that A will be replaced by D, B will be replaced by X, C will be replaced by P, D will be replaced by B, and so on. So, actually you will be getting for the 26 letters, you will be getting another 26 letters which will be telling you which letter to replace by which. So, this new combination of letters, this will be regarded as the key, right? This is the basic idea behind monoalphabetic cipher. As I said, a typical key will look like this, any combination of the 26 alphabets. Drawbacks in this method are, we can make guesses by observing the relative frequency of letters. See, we can make substitution, we can substitute one letter by another, but we are not able to hide the natural statistics that is present in English language. Like, for example, statistics might say that S is the most frequent word, A is the next frequent. So, I can just count the number of occurrences of the different letters. The most frequent letter I find it is K. I substitute k by s, so I make a guess that most probably k is equivalent of s. So in this way I can make guesses based on single letters, based on pairs of letters called digrams, three letter combinations called trigrams, and so on, and you can very easily break the message. This is also quite easy to break depending on the statistical properties, as I had said. But one thing, brute force attack as such will be difficult here because the number of possible keys will be 26 factorial or 4 into 1026. So, brute force attack is possible, but you will need a computer for the purpose. You cannot possibly very easily do it by hand. Okay? Transposition cipher, let us look at one example of this. Here we had said that we are trying to permute or change the order of appearance of the letters. Now, the method or the scheme we talk about here is fairly simple. What we say is that we write out the plain text in a rectangular form. We'll just illustrate with the help of an example. The rectangular form we are writing in a row by row form, and we are reading out the characters column by column by permuting the order of the columns. This let's explain with the help of an example. And here the key is the order of the column and the size, number of columns. Let's explain this with the help of an example. Suppose our plain text is this. We are attending one conference at IIT Kharagpur. So at the first step, we select that the number of letters in the key will be 7. So we create a matrix with 7 number of columns, and we simply go on writing this text like this. We are ATTEN attending one conference at IIT Kharagpur. Last one is gap. Well, in this example, I am ignoring blank spaces, but in practice, blank spaces will also be there. So we write the text just like this in the form of a matrix. Then we define an order of the key. Not the key, order of the columns, in fact. Say, for example, I say that the third column is marked as 1, fourth column as 2, second column as 3, this one as 4, then 5, then 6, then 7. So, this particular combination now becomes the key. Because when you are converting this plain text to ciphertext, what you do? We now read column wise. But which column first? We first read the column numbered as 1. So, A, N, E, E, I, G. So, A, N, E, E, I, G. Okay. Then you read out column 2, R, D, C, N, T, P, R, D, C, N, T, P. Then column 3, E, E, N, R, I, A, and so on. In this way, you go on reading it column wise. So, you understand, in order to break or decode this kind of a ciphertext, we need to know two things. We need to guess the size of the matrix in terms of the number of columns, and then the order of the columns. Now, this code again is not very difficult to break, as number one, the ciphertext has the same letter frequency as the original plain text. We are not modifying any letter by any other letter. So, the most important part here will be to make a guess regarding the number of columns and some probable words in the text which usually we can guess. Like, for example, if you have made the guess correctly in terms of the number of columns, you try to arrange the ciphertext in that many columns. Now, you again imagine, you consider that computer is a possible keyword. So, you try to search and find out where computer, these 8 letters are appearing in a jumbled up form. Like, for instance, you may find that in the matrix, somewhere we have seen you have something like this. You find that there is a jumbled up version of computer existing somewhere. So, you can immediately tell this will be your column number 1, this will be your column number 2, this will be your column number 3, and so on. This will be 4, this will be 5, this will be 6, this will be 7, and this will be 8. So, once you have found this out, you can easily read out the matrix in the order of these columns and you get back the original plain text. So, these methods are interesting in the sense that you can play around with it, but in terms of breaking complexity, these are not good at all. So, in practice, people use more complicated kind of ciphers. Some of them we will have a look at. Now, let us look at one thing before actually going into some practical algorithm. Let us look at two different kind of ciphers we talk about: stream ciphers, block ciphers. Now, a stream cipher encrypts the plain text bit by bit in streams. The idea is like this. Suppose I have a stream cipher generating block here. My plain text is coming here, my ciphertext is being generated here. And I am driving this block by the secret key. Now, the idea is that this plain text is considered to be a stream of zeros and ones typically. That is why it is called a stream. And similarly, a stream of encrypted bit stream will be generated on the other side. So, a stream cipher continuously converts the incoming bit stream into the outgoing bit stream. See, most of the stream ciphers actually have a some kind of a pseudorandom generator block. Then there is an exclusive OR gate which takes the input bit stream, the pseudorandom bits generated, and then it generates the output bit stream. There are variations to this, of course, but there are applications where this kind of stream ciphers are desirable. Number one, stream ciphers are much faster because they can be very easily implemented by hardware, and the amount of hardware required is also pretty less. Secondly, there are applications like speech. You are sending speech information over, say, it can be mobile phone, it can be over satellite, it can be whatever. But you want to do some kind of a some encryption while you are sending. Now, speech is continuous. Your speech, the data you are encoding into digital, that is coming continuously. So, under these circumstances, stream cipher may prove to be more advantageous. Now, a block cipher, in contrast, takes the input plain text block by block. It takes an n bit block at a time and it will convert it into a cipher text. For example, a 256 bit cipher will encrypt 256 bit blocks at a time. Like, again, let us take an example. Suppose we have an input message where I am dividing it up into equal size blocks. This is your block 1, block 2, block 3. Typically, these blocks will be having certain sizes. If the last block is smaller, you can add some pads to make it equal to that minimum size. Now, you can convert or encrypt each of these blocks separately to generate the ciphertext blocks. This is the essential idea behind block cipher. So, here encryption is taking place in terms of blocks of bits. Decryption will also take place in terms of blocks of bits. So, encryption and decryption are not bit by bit continuous, it is block by block. Let us now look at some of the practical algorithms that people use in stream ciphers. Data encryption standard is one of the oldest and one of the most widely used algorithms till very recently. This was developed by the US government, Department of Defense. Here, the block size is 64 bits, the secret key is 56 bits. So, we will be looking into this algorithm in some detail. There is another method called IDEA, this is an acronym IDEA. Here, block size is 64 bits again, but key size is longer. This advanced encryption standard is the most recently proposed algorithm. This is considered to be the standard which is to be adopted and used at least in the near future. This has a separate, this is also known as Rindal crypto system. This name has come from the person who has made this proposal. Here, the block size and key size may vary. They can be 128, 192 or 256 bits. Let us now look into some detail about the data encryption standard or DES. DES is the most widely used encryption scheme. As I said, till very recently, now people have started to use other methods because people have started to suspect that the security that is offered by DES may not be sufficient for many applications. I need some algorithm which is better than DES. Okay. DES is also sometimes known as data encryption algorithm or DEA. As I said, this is a block cipher. It takes 64 bit blocks, which means the plain text is 64 bits in length. And for the purpose of encryption, the key that is used is 56 bits. So, if you have longer plain texts, then it will be broken up into 64 bit blocks and processed block by block. Now, the next diagram gives you some kind of an overall block diagram of the DES algorithm. Here to start with, the 64 bit plain text is taken. Okay? So, the 64 bit plain text first goes through an initial permutation. Initial permutation means you jumble out the bits in some defined order. Okay? Then you carry out 16 rounds of identical looking operations. We will be coming to this little later. So, after you have completed these 16 rounds, you make a 32 bit swap. 32 bit swap means you have a 64 bit number that is coming, divided up into two halves, 32 and 32, swap the two. The second half you bring it first, the first half you bring it later. So, this is 32 bit swap. And finally, you pass it through a reverse initial permutation block to get back the ciphertext. Now, reverse initial permutation means whatever permutation you did initially, like your first bit went to bit number 3, now in that RIP, the third bit will go back to bit number 1. Okay? So, these permutations are actually used to increase the complexity from the point of view of the intruder. And regarding the rounds, you see the key is coming here, this is a 56 bit key. PC is a permuted charge. Initially you make a permutation of the key, then in every round you make a left circular shift of the residual keys. So, you will be getting different key values in the different rounds, and in each of the rounds you pass it through some other permutation block PC2. Now, here what is happening is the key is a 56 bit quantity. This is also an expansion block. A 56 bit quantity here is expanded into a 64 bit quantity here. So, this creates a permutation, also replicates some of the bits to make it 64. So, as the round number goes, the generated round keys K1, K2 to K16 are generated by this portion of the circuit, and these round blocks are executed one after the other. Now, exactly what kind of operation is carried out in the rounds? Let us see this. The overall processing looks like this: Li equal to Ri minus 1, Ri equal to Li minus 1, F Ri minus 1, Ki. I am trying to explain this. See, we illustrate round number I. Let us say this is the data which has come from round I minus 1, from the previous round. We are dividing this 64 bit data into two halves. The right half we are calling R I minus 1, left half we are calling L I minus 1. Now, our objective of round I is, starting from this, we want to generate another 64 bit quantity, which will be Li and Ri. So, we will have to calculate Li and Ri from these somehow. And another thing is available to us, the key for the ith round Ki. So, the way we do it is as follows: the left half from the 64 bit data of the previous round gets copied into the right half of the next round, and for the remaining part, for calculating the other part, sorry, this is Li and this is Ri. For calculating Ri, we have an exclusive OR function. Exclusive OR function takes Lri minus 1. This diagram I am slightly redrawing, so I make it neater. L I minus 1, R I minus 1, L I, R I, and from here K I is coming. First thing is L I is equal to R I minus 1. I draw it reverse, so it will be like this, and R I will be an exclusive OR function of L I minus 1 and some function, some complex function of K and R I minus 1. So, this function f is a complex function. There is some so called nonlinear operations in that function. It is sometimes also called an S box. So, this is roughly how the rounds are computed, and we have 16 such rounds going on. So, as you can understand, the final ciphertext what you are obtaining, it is not very easy to break that by any of the brute force techniques. Even if you try brute force techniques, a 56 bit key would demand searching of a 2 to the power 56 size space, which is typically infeasible, right. So, there is some concern about DES is that with the fastest computers that are available with the intruders or the hackers, 56 bit key, although it was considered to be sufficient earlier, but today's high security application where you carry out financial transactions electronically, 56 bit key is not considered to be sufficient. So, longer key lengths should be used for that purpose. Now, triple DES was one modification of the DES algorithm which was suggested, and in fact, this is still used in many applications. What the basic idea is that the basic DES algorithm uses a 56 bit key. DES says you run DES, triple DES says you run DES 3 times, possibly on 2 or 3 different key values. So, your effective key size will increase, right. So, in general you can have something like this. You can first encrypt P using K1, then possibly you can decrypt using K2, again encrypt using K3, you can use any combination. So, when you are decrypting, you will first be decrypting using K3, encrypting using K2, decrypting using K1, you will get back the original plain text. So, here if you use 3 runs, your effective key length will become 3 times, right. So, this is the order. So, when you are encrypting, see EDE is not mandatory, you can have also EEE and the next step DDD. This is just to jumble up thing even further. K1, K2, K3, when you are decrypting, it will be in the reverse way around. Last time you had used K3, so here you would have to use K3 first, then K2 and then K1, and this E and D would be reversed. This was E, this will be D. So, by suitably using this key and by suitably using the encryption and decryption functions of DES, you can have an effective system which will be having a much longer key value. Now, one thing I did mention, in the DES algorithm you have the 16 rounds. Now, when you are decrypting, the same hardware can, or the same block can carry out decryption if you just run it in the reverse order. So, it is also fairly easy to have a decryption algorithm by slightly configuring the encryption algorithm. Okay? So, encryption and decryption of DES are also available as hardware implementations in the form of chips. So, they are pretty easy to implement. Now, as I said, DES had been used for a long time, it was considered to be secure, but now we need a replacement, because a lot of analysis on attacks, on theoretical methods of breaking such codes have been analyzed, so that the cracking complexity of DES has been made much less than 2 to the power 56. So, it is now feasible to break on a big computer in a reasonable amount of time. P People have demonstrated exhaustive key search attacks that DES can be broken. You can use triple DES, of course, but this will be slow because effectively you have to run 48 rounds every time, 3 runs of DES. Okay? So this is not a very good solution. So in 1997, NIST, an organization, they sent out an open call for proposals for new ciphers. 15 such candidate applications were accepted in June 98, 5 were shortlisted later. Finally, the Rindal cryptosystem was selected in October 2000 as the so-called advanced encryption standard. So, sometimes people interchangeably use this AES and Rindal to mean the same thing. Technically, there is a small difference, but people use these terms interchangeably. Just a very brief look at the AES cryptosystem. As I said, for AES, block size and the key size both can be varied between 128, 192 or 256 bits. But however, in the AES standard, block length is made 128, although the original Rindal proposal allows all three. Okay, so here is the small difference I just talked about. So when you are talking about the AES standard, the block size is fixed. However, the key length can be varied depending on the level of security you need. AES looks somewhat simpler to DES, but similar to DES, but the operations are slightly different. AES is also easy to implement both in hardware and also in software, and this is also resistant against all known kind of attacks. Now, in this context, let me tell you that when we talk about attacks on cryptosystems, this attack on cryptosystems is by itself a separate topic. This is called cryptanalysis. So, there are many methods or schemes that have been utilized, that have been proposed and used for carrying out this sort of cryptanalysis. And this AES cryptosystem, it has been theoretically proved that no amount of cryptanalysis can break this system within a reasonable amount of time. Of course, we do not know of the future. Maybe tomorrow someone may come up with a scheme with which we can possibly have a better attack. But what I am trying to say is that there are other non-conventional attacks, like these are called side channel attacks. Like you can measure the electromagnetic radiation emitted by a device during encryption. You can measure the current flowing during the encryption process. There will be some small variations. Analyzing the variations, you can get a lot of insight about the operation of the device. So, unless your implementation is done in a proper way, this kind of side channel attack can reveal lot of sensitive information about the key you are using or some other secret things. Okay. So, with this, we come to the end of today's lecture. In the next lecture, we shall be continuing with this. We shall be looking at the public key cryptosystem first. Then we shall be looking at some issues of authentication. Okay. So, here first let us quickly look at the solutions to the quiz questions of the last lecture. The questions were as follows. What is the main difference between an intranet and extranet? So, as I said, an intranet uses internet technology for information sharing inside an organization only. Extranet basically extends the capability of the intranet to include some external entities like clients, customers, etc. How does a packet filtering router typically filter packets? Based on the source and destination IP addresses and port numbers. How does an application level gateway carry out filtering process? They receive each packet and applies a set of rules which are protocol dependent. For example, in SMTP traffic, it can check the packet body for objectionable contents or viruses, etc. Which would be more suitable for email filtering, packet level filter or application level gateway? See, as I mentioned just now, for email filtering, application level gateway is more suitable because protocol specific checks can be made here. At the packet filtering level, you can only monitor the IP addresses and port numbers. What is a batch chain host? It is a secure and tamper-proof system that serves as a central point in the network security. In the dual-homed host firewall, how many security points must be broken by an intruder before he can get into the internal network? Here it is 2, the router and the batch chain host. However, for the screened subnet firewall, it will be 3, because not only the outside router and the batch chain host, also the inside router has to be broken into, right? So now some questions from today's lecture. What is the main difference between passive and active attacks? 10 parties exchange messages securely using DES. How many distinct key values will be required? What is the main difference between substitution cipher and transmission cipher? For breaking transmission ciphers, what are the initial guesses that need to be made? How many rounds are there in DES? What is the key length of DES? How does triple DES helps to increase the effective key length? So with this, we come to the end of today's lecture. Thank you. In our last lecture, we were talking about some of the network security issues and some of the cryptographic concept. In particular, we talked about the symmetric key encryption-decryption techniques. We looked at some of the classical algorithms like Caesar cipher, monoalphabetic cipher, transposition cipher, and we also looked at some of the practical schemes that people use like DES, triple DES, and you also mentioned about the standard which people use nowadays, AES. So continuing with our discussion, today we shall be first looking at public key cryptography. Now let us first try to understand the motivation before trying to explain what public key cryptography is. See, symmetric key cryptography methods like DES, triple DES, AES, all are fine. They are pretty strong algorithms,